Okay, greetings. This is Christopher Moyer.
And I'm Jane Anderson.
And we are at the Psychology Department here at University of Wisconsin-Stout. And this is a presentation of some research that we and colleagues collaborated on that was just recently published. And in addition to being supported by University of Wisconsin-Stout, this has also been supported by a lab and instruction grant from the National Science Foundation, which supports our CNERV cognitive neuroscience organization here at Stout. And the title of our presentation, Just Minutes a Day, is based on the fact that we wanted to research the effect of small amounts of meditation rather than very large amounts of meditation. On to slide two. First, we should say a little bit about what meditation is and how it has been defined in the research. Jane?
So meditation is something that has been practiced for thousands of years, but has really only recently begun to be studied in a clinical way. And it has been defined by Antoine Lutz at the University of Wisconsin-Madison as being a type of attentional regulatory training, which tends to cultivate well-being and emotional balance. As a longtime meditator myself, this is something that I have found to be true. And in my own practice, I found that I began to feel benefits after about 1 month of meditation practice. And so I was very interested in looking at why it might be that one began to feel well-being and emotional balance, what was happening in the brain, and also if that might actually be visible in the brain after only 1 month or so of practice. There are two main types of meditation that have been studied. One is focused attention, where you bring as much attention as you can to a single point and then notice when other thoughts arise, and then in a non-judgmental way you bring your attention back to that focus point. And there is also an open monitoring sort of meditation, which is more like Zen meditation, where you are just as aware as possible in the present moment. That tends to be a bit more difficult for Westerners, and so we tend to begin with focused attention meditation.
And we've included some pictures of the research team in the slides that we're showing you here today. We did in fact test the procedures on ourselves when we were setting up the research, but I want to point out that even though the pictures may look like we ourselves were research subjects, we were not subjects in the actual research. We just tested the procedures on ourselves initially. On the slide three, there is a pretty good body of research literature building up about meditation. And in some cases, this research is about very, very large amounts of meditation practice. So for example, there has been research with expert Buddhist meditators who have accumulated 10,000 to 50,000 hours of meditation practice across their lifetime. To put that into context, a 40-hour-a-week job for an entire year would have you at work about 2,000 hours. So we are talking about years and years of concentrated full-time practice, lifetime practice here. These experts have been studied, and it's found that when they meditate, some very interesting things, changes occur in the way that the electrical activity of their brain is patterned. I'm not going to go into the details of that, but we have the reference there, and at the end of this presentation, if you want to look up the original paper. But in essence, the way that their brain is patterning its electrical signals becomes different and unique compared to non-meditative states. Now, closer to what many of us might want to try or experience, there has also been research on what we might call brief meditation training. So there is a standardized protocol in mindfulness-based stress reduction. that has been used in a couple of different research studies. This consists of about 70 hours of training and practice spread across 8 weeks. So this is a much, much smaller number, but it's still a pretty large number. 70 hours is a lot of time. Now, when this amount has been studied, other researchers have found that changes in the brain occur. The increased gray matter in the left hippocampus, and also a shift in the EEG asymmetry of the frontal portion of the brain towards a pattern associated with positive emotion. This turns out to be what we decided to emphasize in our research as well. On the slide four, so there is a theory that has been well validated by a range of different types of research that shows that mammalian brains are specialized such that one hemisphere of the brain is more associated with approach-oriented positive emotions. These would be things like love, interest, attraction. Jane?
Enthusiasm, joy, and in general, a very positive attitude toward life.
Good. And the right hemisphere is more associated with the opposite, with avoidance-oriented negative emotions, the kind of mental states that cause you to steer clear of something, fear, anxiety, possibly depression. Want to add anything to that, Jane?
No, I think any of the emotions or thoughts that you would associate with depression tend to occur in that right hemisphere.
Now, I might disagree with you a little bit on that, Jane,
but
we might want to emphasize that we're looking at the relative balance of electrical activity here, such that positive emotions are associated with a greater relative balance of electrical activity in the frontal left hemisphere, and avoidance-oriented emotions are associated with the opposite. On to the next slide, slide number five. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to study a smaller amount of meditation training than anyone had studied before to see if it would have an effect on that balance of EEG activity, or more precisely on EEG asymmetry. Now, research reports will give you all of the relevant scientific detail of a study, but sometimes what they don't give you is the behind the scenes background or some of the decision making that took place on the way to that study. And while this certainly was the question we were interested in, it also, one of the reasons we were interested in this question is because it was something we were able to do. Even if we had wanted to study dozens or hundreds or thousands of hours of meditation, we might not have been in a good position to do that given the resources that we had. So what we did have access to were two experienced meditation instructors. Jane was one of them. We had a very dedicated team of well-trained researchers. We had a 64-channel EGI EEG machine, which is a really fine piece of equipment. And we had access to a reasonable number of participants. But what we didn't have is a whole lot of money, a tremendous amount of time, or some kind of unlimited number of participants. We were going to be looking at a couple dozen participants, not hundreds of participants. So these were the resources that we were working with, and they shaped our research question a bit.